Welcome to Data Structures and Applications subject. I am Dr. S. Nandagopalan, continuing the session. Last class we have seen details of the normal queues, how a normal queue works. For instance, how to add an element, how to delete an element, etc. So in this session, let me just discuss about the circular queues. Before we actually go into the details of circular queues, we should know why we are talking about circular queues. In other words, what are the problems which we are trying to get with the normal queues? So let me just go to the PPT. Right, so we have the circular queue explanation in this first slide. So before we take up this, as I said, we need to understand the drawbacks of the normal queues. Now, if you look at the scenario where, for instance, I may have some elements being added into the queue and deleted as well. So for instance, you can take up this scenario where I have two elements, 20 and 30 in the queue, and I could add one more. Say for example, this is added and R will get moved to this. Now it cannot be added any more elements into the queue because R plus 1 is equal to, or R equal to max minus 1. Or n minus 1. That means that you will get an exception, that means error message saying that the queue is full, though there is a space here. So this is what we explained in the previous class, that we should be able to utilize this space as well, which can be done by taking up another type of queue called a circular queue. Now that's exactly what we are going to see here in this session. So this explains the reason why we require circular queues. In other words, the problem associated with the ordinary queue. So irrespective of the front pointer, the queue status is full, etc. Because we check only R equal to this. So everything is based upon rear pointer, and obviously we cannot blame this concept. Okay, so what we are going to do is that, let's assume a general queue structure with n, elements being the size for the queue. So we have, starting from 0, n minus 1, and one more n we will take. I'll come to this explanation later. So instead of thinking the queue as a flat one, we can think of the queue as a circular one. So starting from f pointing to 0, you can see here, pointing to 0, and R is pointing to 30. You can see here, R is pointing to 30 here, and so on. So next one is 4. R is pointing to, because in circular queue, the maintenance of these front pointer and rear pointer are slightly different from the normal queues. Okay, so as we progress towards some more slides, you will understand the placing of these pointers. In other words, you can see here that front pointer is not pointing to 0. Sorry, front pointer is pointing to 0, but the elements are not starting from 0. For example, here in the flat queue, elements are starting from 0, but here it's starting from 1. So we deliberately waste one location here. Why? Because of the formula which we will use in order to insert and delete. So wait for some more slides to come so that automatically you can easily understand. Right. So the elements are not going to start from 0, but it's going to start from 1. And rear point is going to point to the filled element as usual. Since it's starting from 1, you get a difference here So it's pushed. So here 10, here 20, here it's 30 according to the circular queue. Okay, so still, you know, we are going to increment or and then add an element. We'll see. So how to get the address for addition, I have to get the address for deletion as far as the front end rear pointers are concerned. But here what we are talking about is the circular one, where the queue is thought of as if that, supposing if I have n minus 1 elements in the array, that is 0 to n minus 1, n elements, I'm going to just use up to n, an extra one. So we essentially think of 0 to n. So maybe max plus 1 will be the total space being occupied. Right. Well, so here we have these kinds of, settings. If it's done, then we can devise formulas in order to actually insert and delete elements in a circular queue and utilize the space even if there are some vacant spaces in the queue. Why? The fundamental concept in the circular queue is that we have seen in the earlier normal queue case that front pointer will catch rear pointer and it will not cross rear pointer, right? But in this case, it's not like that. Both the pointers may keep rotating. That is to make sure that even if, you know, you find a situation like this, where R has come here and front, if you start deleting, you know, F will keep moving and R can actually come back here, that means circular fashion, and start utilizing these spaces. And front also can come, you know, like this, back to this. Now, how to make these front and rear pointers to keep, you know, coming back to the initial position like zero? That means in a wraparound fashion or circular fashion, that's being done by using the formulas, as I said. So instead of thinking of that front will catch rear and it will not go beyond that, or R will go only up to n minus 1. All those concepts may not be useful here, but we should make sure that front and rear pointers should keep rotating. How? Okay, this is the way by which we can do it. So we have two operations here, enter into circular queue and delete. Similar to normal queue, but here I just added one letter called C. Fine. Now this is very important, initialization. So unlike in normal queue, where F is initialized to 0, R is minus 1, here we initialize both F and R to 0. That's very important. And an element E is added into the circular queue using this formula. So R is not simply incremented and added, I mean a new element, but R is going to be an address which is computed by using this formula. Now let us spend a few minutes in order to understand the concept behind this formula. This formula uses mod. What is mod? Mod is nothing but it gives a reminder, percentage in C language. Okay. So for example, when I reach maximum, for example, 4 is the maximum size of the queue. So when R reaches 4 or 3, let's take, 3 mod 4 is again 3. So, you know, you'll be able to. So R, when it is 3 plus, we are trying to find whether I can add any more elements. So 3 plus 1, 4, 4 mod 1 is actually 0. So you are actually wrapping around the rear pointer back to the front. So you are able to, send or make the rear pointer back to until that time. For example, when R is 1, let's take, when R is 1, R, let's start from 0. 0 plus 1 is 1. 1 mod 4 is again 1 only. Similarly, if you take 1, 1 plus 1 is 2. 2 mod 4 is again 2 only. So it won't change. It won't wrap around. Now 2, 2 plus 1 is 3. 3 mod 4 is 3 again, so it's not going to get wraparound. So when it reaches the last one, that is 3 plus 1, 4, 4 mod 4 is actually 0. So you are making the rear pointer back to 0, provided if there is some space, we can actually add. So rear pointer doesn't get a dead end, unlike in normal queue, because there we simply check r plus 1 is equal to, sorry, r equal to max minus 1. So that is not going to happen here. We are able to move the rear pointer back to 1 using this mod. So mod helps us in order to move around or wrap around these pointers. This is true even for f. So similar formula is used for deletion as well, where f is modified using, or f address is calculated using mod. So we have this formula. So whenever you want to add an element into the circular queue, you have to apply this formula, get the value of r, then you can add the element. That means q of r pointed by r is equal to e, the element to be added to the circular queue. So we have a very simple formula which would help us in making R to wrap around using mod. Okay, so let's understand this using a few sample data, starting from no element in the queue, initial condition, where both f and r is equal to 0. That means that's how the initialization is done. Now, when you want to add, so for example, 10, you first compute r equal to r plus 1 mod n. So as I said earlier, 0 plus 1, the maximum size is say 7 in this case, sorry, 8, because 0 to 7, but actually we use 1 less, because one location is never used, 0 to 1. Right. So what we have here, let's take 7. So 0 plus 1 is 1. 1 mod 7 is 1 again. So it is added at first location. Or if you want to add 20, again the same thing. R plus 1, which is 2. So mod will give me again 2 only. So it's added at 2. You can see here. 3. Yes. So 30. 40, 50, 60, 70. So up to this, it is all added. But when you reach R to this point, now, strictly speaking, there is no space in the circular queue, because this is not used, because this is a dummy place, right? One location is wasted. So this is a dummy place. So R, as long as it's within this, r plus 1 mod n gives me this value. For example, when r is 6, so r plus 1 is 7, 7 mod 8 is 7 again, 7 mod 8 is 7 again, so it comes here, total is 8. And so up to 7 I can add. Beyond that, I cannot add. But when suppose some elements are deleted, then probably I can get. So that's what we are going to see here. So before we come to that exception case, let's see how the deletion works. That's very simple. Again, we use a formula, as I said earlier. F is also done in the same way, f plus 1 mod n. R equal to r plus 1 mod n. Here, f is also same thing. So this is a case where all the locations in the circular queue is full or entered with the elements, and I want to delete. So what happens? 0 plus 1 is 1, because f value is 0. 1 mod 8 is 1 again. So element pointed by f, which is 1 in this case, will be deleted, right? So it's deleted. So now what happens? Because f is now pointing to 1. You can see that always f points to an unfilled element, unlike normal queue. So f is pointing to an unfilled one. Supposing if I want to delete the next element, because that's the 20 which is added after 10, first in, first out. And hence, so 1 plus 1 is 2, 2 mod 8 is again 2. So I'll get this being deleted. So deletion also works fine. But we should see whether we are able to use this space in a circular fashion. Okay, that's exactly what this slide shows, where this is the scenario where 10 is deleted and f is pointing to 1. You can see here 10 is deleted, f is pointing to 1. So under these circumstances, in the normal queue, we'll not be able to add because R reached the end of the queue, but here it's not so. Here we have some space, this space should be utilized. How? This is what the advantage of the circular queue. Remember, always F is here, and prior to this, we can utilize this. Okay, now let's assume that I want to add a new element. Okay, now what we do is R plus 1, which is 7 plus 1, 8. 8 mod 8 is 0, so I should be able to add this. You can see here, it's done. So I'm able to, so this is initial after delete, sorry. So I can do that by adding immediately for this particular case. So I can add at this, at this a new element, or assume that I want to delete 20 again. I want to have two elements being vacant. Yes, F moves here. You can see here F moves here. And now I want to add, either way it's fine. So I want to add a new element, no problem. R plus 1 will give me 0. So at 0th place, that is this one, I can add 99. So I'm not wasting. Now assume that I want to add one more element, 88. Again, R plus 1 is 1. Mod 8 is again 1. So I can add an element here and R moves here. But exception, real queue full case, we have to check. So how do we check that? Overflow, for example, when F equals R plus 1 mod N, then we say that queue is full. So let us assume that we have an element here again. Okay. Let us assume that I have an element here. So that means my F will be pointing this to this. That's exactly what we had this scenario, right? Initial status. That means all elements are there and F is here. That means you don't have space in the circular queue. And in other words, when you want to add an element, it should give me an error. That means overflow. So this formula will be used in order to do that. So we are trying to check whether R plus 1, so it is 8, R plus 1 is 8. What is N? 8. So 8 mod 8 equal to 0. So what is F? It is 0, and hence it's an odd. So when F and R plus 1 mod N, is equal, it's not necessarily 0. If these two values are equal, because recall that F and R may keep moving. For example, assume that I have added 99, I have added 88, so my R comes here. So what is F? F is 2, F is 2, and what is R? R is 1. So R plus 1 is 2, 2 mod 8 is 2, so R value is 2. So F and R are equal, and hence it is overflow. So this formula, if F equals R plus 1 mod N, which means that you don't have space. So this is exactly what, that means F is front, that means prior to, or after R, we can say, and R is behind. So R plus 1 will try to check whether it's adjacent values. If adjacent values are there, that means you don't have space. If they are not adjacent, F and R, probably you have some. You can see here R is here, F is here. That means some vacant spaces are there. So we can easily add. Underflow condition, that means when Q is empty, that means F and R both are same. So that means you keep deleting. For instance, F is deleted here, F moves here, 20 is deleted, 30 is deleted, etc. Okay, this is deleted, this is deleted, this is deleted, this is deleted, and this also deleted, and F may point to here. So when you delete F plus 1, F is not equal to R, that means still some elements are there. So I want to delete, so what happens? F new value for F is 6 plus 1, 7, 7 mod 8 is 7 again. And hence it will come here, catching R, that means this element is gone and no more elements are there. That means when F catches R, in other words, F equals R, no more elements. In other words, it's an underflow, right? So very important changes with respect to normal queue is that initialization, then the way in which you calculate the value for R and F for addition and deletion, and exception checking, overflow, and all are changed. Using any if then else kind of cases, we are calculating the F and R values using these formulas. So these formulas are very useful in order to make sure that the extra spaces which we have, or the normal locations which are free, can easily be utilized by way of computing F and R value. So this is the concept behind circular queue. So now it's time to see the algorithm. Algorithm is very simple, only formula. So this is exception case, overflow case. So when F equal to R plus 1 mod n, simply say that it's overflow. Else you can actually compute R and add the element into the queue, as we have seen just now. Deletion, same underflow checking. When F equal to R, it's underflow. Otherwise, compute F and you can return pointed by it. Or you can save it in temp and then return. Either way, it's fine. So very, very straightforward algorithms. In both the cases, this formula is the most important. The heart of these algorithms are this computation of R address and the F address. Well, now, similar to stack, where we have seen that static allocation of arrays have some limitations of adding your elements. At runtime, you cannot increase its size. And in the sense that normal queues, we declare an array of maximum size, say 10. And you cannot increase the size of the stack or queue, circle, anything, beyond that at runtime. There are situations, as we have explained already, that I may want more space. Say I've declared 100, but I'm going out of 100. That means I need more space. So what do I do? So I need to actually go for dynamic arrays, which means that using MLF or CALOC, I can dynamically increase my size of, the queue or stack, circular queue, anything. So I should be able to utilize these functions, dynamic allocation functions, in order to increase my space at runtime. And it may look very simple. Normal queue, it is similar to stack. There is absolutely no difference. But in circular queue, you cannot apply the same concept in order to increase the size dynamically. See, what we have done, just to recall, in stack, whenever you find that your initial allocation is full, you request for double the size, right? That means you get more space. Now you can keep pushing your elements into the stack. Same thing is true in queue. Okay, I have declared 5 as my maximum, and now I'm running out, so I just double it. So I'll get 10 more. Now the problem is, in circular queue, also if we apply the same concept, definitely it's not going to work. Why? That we will explain in two slides. Then we will study how to fix this issue. Okay, so first two slides, it is simply to understand the problem associated with simple expansion of memory. So let us assume a scenario where I have seven elements only can be added. That means my maximum size of the circular queue is seven. And you can see here that, see, instead of showing it in a circular fashion, I've just shown in a flat manner because expansion of memory should be shown properly. Now the queue is full. Why? Because we had seen the formula just now. If f equal to r plus 1 mod n, what is f? It is 4. You know, f is 4. What is the right hand side? R plus 1, that is 3 plus 1 is 4, mod n, 4 mod n. So what is n? 7. It's 4. So my r, that means f equals this value, that is whatever the computation you are doing. It is also 4, this is also 4. You can see this what I've done here. And hence we say that it is full, right? So it's an overflow. So what do? We just double. That means I get 7 more locations. Okay. So what do? We'll show that scenario in the next slide. So up to this, 0 to 6 was my old, you can see here, this 0 to 6. So AABB, exactly the same. This is old. This much is old. And I have requested for new using queueful to expand the memory. So this is my newly allocated memory space dynamic. Right? Okay. Now I'll just delete all this or erase this. So now we have from here to here old, from here to here new. So now assume that I want to insert a new element into the circular queue. Again, the same formula. Same formula is what? See whether f equals r plus 1 mod n. Again, the same thing, because r and f are same. Like r was 3, f is 4. Same thing. So I would get the same 4, you know. Same value I'll get. Still, it will tell me that it is an overflow condition. So what is the use of this expanded memory? No, I'm not able to use it. So what went wrong? What went wrong is basically that it's not working as a circular fashion because my R and F are still pointing to this. Something I have to do to fix this. That means I have to alter my R and F, etc., etc. So we'll see the steps of this. But the problem associated with this is very, very evident, that simply expanding memory will not work in the case of circular queue. Now that's exactly what is the problem. Right. What do is, let me put things in perspective by using these steps. So first step is to allocate new array of twice the size. No problem, we have done that already. Next, copy the values in the range from the existing one, f plus 1 to, you know, capacity, maybe full one, the initial capacity. Capacity is 7, into the new array. That means new queue, starting from 0, starting at 0 of the new array. That means new queue. Basically, what we are trying to do here is that f plus 1 to capacity minus 1. So f plus 1, you can see here, this to this, right? Capacity is 7, 7 minus 1, 6, so this much. So basically, this is to make sure that we are trying to utilize the space starting from the beginning. Okay, so the second step is clear. Third, copy the values in the range Q of 0 to R, that the balanced one, into the new array, starting at capacity minus F minus 1. I'll show you all this in the next slide, the new array. So we are just doing two copy works. One, F, that means F plus 1 onwards up to the end of the queue, into a new array. And then from 0 to remaining one, I think 0 to, you can see 0 to R. So 0 to R. So this much, again, it should go into the new array after this. So this is number one. This is number two. So starting from F plus 1 up to the end of the circular queue, push it to the beginning of the circular queue, new, array. And the balance one starting from 0 to R, put it after this. Okay, there's a two-stage copy. Next, adjust the front and rear pointers. So, okay, how? Fix the value for F and R. I'll show you that. Yeah, so this is F. Okay, I think there is some mistake, so remove this. Typographical error. So F, move it to 2 into capacity minus 1 and R capacity minus 2. So I'll show you this case in the next slide. Why we should do this? Because when you copy the old elements to the new array, basically we are trying to make sure that you can utilize the expanded memory as well. Right. So after you do this, how does it look like? So this is before. It is simple, expanded memory, that's it. And R and F remain same. So as I said earlier, we need to first copy the new array. Okay, this is the new array. After copying, it looks like this. So what we have done essentially is that F plus 1 to capacity minus 1. So this one has been copied from 0. You can see here, this is copied from 0 to whatever the size. So this much is copied. The next copying work is from 0 to R. You can see here, this much is copied. Next, of course, it's this one. It's understood. And adjust the pointers. So F equals 2 into capacity minus. So capacity is 7. 14 minus 1 is 13. So F is 13, you can see here. F goes to the last location. Okay. Next, R equals capacity minus 2, that is 5. So R is 5. It's basically to make sure that it points to the end of this filled element. That's what we want in the circular queue. So now we have adjusted the pointers F and R in such a way that now R can move like this, wherein you can add elements. So compute the new value for R, R plus 1 mod. What is the new value? It is 14. So 6 mod 14 is 6 again. So I can add an element and R can be moved here. Now it works. So whenever you expand memory, the first thing is to make sure that you adjust this copy work and then adjust the pointers in order to utilize this. So whenever queueful is called, it's not enough to just start using this memory, but we need to adjust the pointers after copying. So if you do this, then it would work without any problem. So let me just summarize this. So first thing is to make sure that from f plus 1 to capacity minus 1, these elements are copied starting from 0. And second copy is starting from 0 to r. So this is first copy. And this is second copy. So the first copy goes here. And the second copy goes here. And f and r are adjusted as per the formula, this one. If so, we are able to get the unused space for further addition. Right, so this is to make sure that your normal Q, you know, what drawbacks we had could be solved by using a circular Q. And also another problem of limited space can be solved by using dynamic arrays. So normal queue, circular queue, fine. It's first in, first out concept. Still remains first in, first out. When we break this first in, first out, then we get into another type of queue called as priority queue. So what do you mean by breaking this? First in, first out. What is the meaning of breaking it out? Breaking it out means, instead of allowing who had come first, we can actually make sure that, okay, there are some people standing in the queue or some people, I can just give some priority to some people and call, irrespective of, you know, even a person has come first, he's not being called. Even a person who has come late or after all this, he may have a higher priority and hence call for service. So deletion is not really based on the person who has come first, but it's based on some priority associated with the element or the object. So this FIFO policy or the first in, first out concept is actually broken, and we introduce another element here, another tag called priority. Higher priority jobs are taken first by the processor. Higher priority people may be allowed to enter into some place, offices or temple or, you know, hospitals, or you would have seen even in the airports that business class people are called first. Even if they have arrived late, doesn't matter. All may be sitting at the gate, but, you know, economy class people are called after the business class. Why? Because they have higher priority. They are paid more, actually. So when the priority is attached, then we have to delete based upon the priority. Addition, it's same, like whoever comes, whatever the fashion, doesn't matter. We simply put them in the array. Still, we consider array as the container and we try to add the elements. Okay? So normally elements are deleted either in the increasing or decreasing order of priority. So there are two ways, you know. I just say that the elemental value itself decides me the priority, or I can attach another tag to it. So supposing if I have ascending priority queue, that means 1 has got the highest priority, 10 may have the lower. Descending, it could be the other way, like 10 has the higher priority and 1 may have the lower priority. So ascending and descending priority queues also can be designed. Okay, so an element in the highest priority may have to be deleted first, irrespective of where and when the person has arrived. So insert can be done, insertion can also be done by the priority, deletion also based upon the priority. This is one way, but insertion can be keep on like even in the same array, because that's easier, because this is difficult by, you know, by inserting, because I have to push these elements either this way or that way. So that is costly affair. Supposing if I have 1 million elements here, I assume that somebody has come with a higher priority, I cannot just insert because I have to push this element. So normally that is not done. So we have a very interesting concept or algorithm for this. So there are plenty of applications, as I've just now mentioned, auctions and stock market, simulations of airports, I just now said, parking lots, all that, temples, greedy algorithms, priority queues may be used to pull largest item because you are more greedy to take the largest one. Priority can all be used to manage bandwidth in a shared network traffic. So this is also useful in, whoever has paid more, so they might get higher bandwidth because they have higher priority. And in the discrete event simulation, so managing the event. So higher priority events may be executed first, lower priority one may be later. So this you will study in later semesters, for example, in database management systems, transaction processing. So higher priority transactions may have to be executed first. Okay, so what is ascending priority queue or min priority queue? Element with the minimum value will be the highest. Is the higher priority. One has got higher priority than 10. Descending, it's exactly reverse. 10 has got the highest priority than the 1 value. So it's descending priority. But as I said just now, implementing the ascending or descending priority queues by adding element into an appropriate position in the existing array is not a good idea. So we have an efficient method. So there are two operations which are normally talked about for priority queue operations. One is enter priority queue and delete, similar to enter queue and delete queue, enter circular queue, delete circular queue. Here it is P, that is priority. So any element, which need to be added, let's say X, irrespective of its priority, it is simply added at the end. Delete, it is deleted based upon its highest value. Let's say the descending priority queue. That means highest value comes first. Okay, so in order to do these two operations, both the operations, we use only one pointer called index. Remember stack, we have used one pointer called stack pointer. In queue, we have used two pointers, front and rear. In circular queue, again, we have used two pointers, front and rear. Again, in priority queues, we use only one pointer called index. So initial value of index is considered as -1. And whenever you want to add any new element, any element into the priority queue, increment index and then add. That's it. Okay. So for example, assume that I want to add irrespective of its priority. So see, remember here the elemental value, etc., everything is associated with the priority itself. But in the real scenario, I may have an object where, for example, a student. So USN may be the key and priority may be something else, right? Priority may be something else. So I'm not considering the rest of the attributes or the details of this object. I'm just considering only one value which gives me the priority. For instance, 10 and 9, 10 has got a higher priority than 9. That's it. Okay, so 10 is some element being added. So just increment index and add it. Because entering into the priority queue, we don't look at its priority. Simply keep on adding. 25, no problem. Increment index, add. 15, 17, 11, 21, yes, it's full because static allocation. So there are 6 element space, so I've just added. So index comes here. So you can see here that they're all put in a haphazard manner. As and when they have arrived, they are just added into the priority queue. Now only the question is deletion. So algorithm for addition is very simple. Increment index, simply push it into the priority queue array. Deletion. Okay, now let's assume that deletion has to be performed on this priority queue. Now, which element should be deleted first? 25, because this fellow has got the highest priority. 25 would have come late. That doesn't matter. So what we have here is that we should know how to delete this 25 among all these six elements. It's very simple. So find the largest one and then delete. But the problem is, if you do that, okay, you delete, but you have some empty space. Supposing element to be deleted, 21, which is the next highest priority, so this is deleted. Next is 17, so this is deleted. So you get gaps. You can see here 10 empty, 15 empty, 11 empty. So how do you recompact? So every time when you delete, you have to recompact the array. Now this is all headache. Recompaction, assume 1 million elements are there in an array. Every time, I cannot keep on recompacting. That means push this element this way, that way. That's not possible. We need an efficient method. How? We'll explain this. So deletion can be done very easily. You find the largest one. So you have found this one. So once you find the largest element, swap it with the last one. You can see here. Swap it with the last one. So 21 comes here, 25 goes to the last, which means that you can see here 21 is this one, 25 is this. So this is immaterial actually. Why? Because next step is to decrement index. Index was pointing here and I just make index to point here. So this is gone. So after finding this largest element, I'll just save this in a temporary variable because that's the element to be returned as the highest priority one. So I'm not leaving this gap. So in order to fill this gap, I'm swapping with the element which is there in the last. So all that I need to do is, supposing assume that this is my kth location, which gives me the largest one. So I need to just swap element pointed by k and element pointed by index. So which I have done. Decrement index is done. Oh, so I just return element pointed by this k, which has been stored in the temporary variable. Now what happens? I have only these many elements. That means 5 elements. Now let's assume that I want to delete the next highest priority one, right? Again, apply the same procedure of finding which is the next largest, which is 21. Again, swap pointed by index. So 21 goes here, 21, and index will come here. So index is not here, index is here, right? And whatever we have already saved, this 21 temporary variable, that will be sent back to the calling program. So now no recompaction, nothing. I simply find one algorithm which is of the order of n, because finding the largest element you already studied. So that is going to give me just of the order of n. So no back and forth movement. So it's very easy to find the largest, swap it with the last element, and simply adjust index by decrementing by one. So we'll see two algorithms now, one for addition and for deletion, based upon these concepts. So addition, this is simple, exception case. When index is n minus max minus 1, it's full. Otherwise, you increment index and push the element into the queue pointed, priority queue pointed by index. Done. Now, supposing if I want to delete, what are the steps? First, find the largest. So this will give me that, finding the largest. See, start from one. Assume this is the largest one. This is you already studied. And then starting from the next element onwards up to the index, if you find anything large, save that. And keep doing this for the rest of the element. So k will give me the position of the largest element. And save that in temporary That means elemental one for returning. You can see. Next, what you should do, swap it. You can see here swapping and decrement index. Done. So that's what we have done here. And deletion is very simple. So step by step, it's very easy. Find the largest and save it. Swap, decrement index. Done. So we are successfully, implemented the concept of this priority queue addition and deletion by using one pointer and the elemental. So instead of just simple element, you can just have a structure which is my object. So you may have n number of parameters for that object. One of them could be just a priority, right? When you wait in a hospital, for instance, let's say, or a bank, based upon your priority, whatever the tag, you can just be called. So that is your priority. That value is the priority. Timestamp may be a priority. That means based upon at what time you had arrived, that will decide who had come first. So like this, there are several scenarios and applications where this priority queue can be implemented for various purposes. So we will wind up our session for the today's session at this point of time. As you can see here, we have another type of queue called as double-ended queue. So here, most of the cases what we have seen so far are single-ended. Double-ended means that you can add and delete on both the ends. Here, it's not like that. Front, deletion, rear, addition. That's it. Stack, both at one end, pushing and popping. So everything, I mean, each work is being carried out for a particular purpose, like insertion at rear, deletion at front. So insertion you cannot do at front in the normal queue or circular queue or priority. So if we are allowed not this front and rear concepts, I assume that everything is same, I should be allowed on either end, let's say, then it leads to another type of queue called as double-ended queue that we will discuss in the next session.